Welcome everyone. This is a lecture on service design, particularly the tools of service design. So I'm going to explain to you what service design is, and if you're going to engage in service design, what you can use to be an effective service design provider or service designer. I always recommend people to take notes when I hold these live lectures, but obviously right now you can just stop the video at any given time and come back later if you like. So first of all, what is this thing we call service design? Service design is a relatively new thing on the market. And it is basically the art of orchestrating how services are provided. As such, what happens is you plan and organize people, all the different people who may be working in organizations, people who may be customers, people who may be patients, people who may be prisoners, you name it. There will be people at the receiving end and there will be people at the active end. And as a service designer, you plan and organize what they do. You also concern yourself with the infrastructure that is required to provide a proper service. And you are covering all the aspects of communication that must happen when the service is provided. So the field of communication as such is one that you may want to read up on, and it's a vast one, depending on which field you are engaging with there as a service designer. There are also going to be material components involved in designing for service, as there always are. So you may want to make yourself aware and familiar with these things. If you're going to design a service around air travel, for example, you'll want to know everything about air travel before you start designing the service. We do this in order to improve services. Sometimes to create them, but usually they already exist, so we improve them in quality and also in terms of the interaction that happens between the service provider and the customers. So that brings us back to the receiving end and the giving end of services that I was talking about at the beginning. So the service design customers, who are they and what do they do? This list here shows possible service design customers. Like I said before, anywhere where people are active, there will be processes, there will be interactions in the interest of service, and you can basically say wherever people do stuff, they're going to need a service designer. Hospitals, insurance companies, restaurants, military, you name it. This list is by no means exhaustive. Basically, wherever people come together in a professional capacity, a service designer will be able to make improvements. To give you one fun example, the Inland Revenue Service of New Zealand, the tax office, actually has service designers in their employ, I hear. So these are service designers working for the tax office to streamline the experience and the processes behind tax paying and tax administration. Let's look at the characteristics of service design. You might be familiar with other kinds of design. Graphic design, product design, car design, they all are very specific things and dedicated to creating and evolving their respective fields. Service design is its own thing again. And official definition basically defines this as follows. Service design is all about specifying and constructing social practices. So you are specifying and constructing what people do. These practices need to be capable and have the capacity for action for a particular customer. So it's never one size fits all. It is always a custom job. And there is very likely technology involved, because these days it's everywhere. As a service designer, you can do tangible or intangible outcomes. Tangible outcomes are obviously artifacts, and you may be surprised how many artifacts you may create as a service designer. Or they can be intangible, such as communication. That means perhaps just standing in front of people and lecturing, like I do now here with you guys. It could be intangible, as in an environment is created due to the culture that is being instilled. So when I'm saying environment, it's not like you're planting trees or putting in new chairs. You are creating environment by changing expectations in people, by increasing knowledge in people, and behaviors can also be changed. A few thoughts on this whole phenomenon. These are three scientists or authors who have been writing quite prolifically on this topic. And they brought up these interesting notions that I think ring very true about service design and other things. First of all, products, as we know them, are usually created and therefore exist before anyone picks them up at the shop. So they are dead things that are waiting to be taken away and learned. That is not how services work. Services are only coming to life by making use of them. So it is a very different thing. Services are not an object, are not a product. They are alive, and they are the most intangible of things that you can imagine. So the difference between products and services is that you can configure a product very precisely, but you cannot entirely configure a service, because there are too many unknowns in it. There will be too many chances of deviation to even budget for these. So you need to allow for a lot of flexibility and improvisation and probably, follow-up work in service design. So actually, I'm thinking a service designer is a bit like a movie director. Because what you're doing is you're suggesting behavioral patterns, scripts even if you like, for all the actors. Actors who are interacting in the service. Isn't it funny that they're calling these guys actors? They're calling them actors not because they actually have a different name and live in Hollywood, but they're acting. And we really call the people who are involved, the stakeholders of any given service transaction, the actors in the service experience. So how come we are only starting this now? Wasn't the world a perfectly good place before this came along, this service design phenomenon? Well, the fact is, yes, we have always had services, but you probably all remember the stories old people tell you of how terrible stuff used to be. Well, and that's exactly the idea. We no longer want terrible service. We want our service experiences to be nice and polished, smooth, pleasant, optimized. And there is obviously something to be gained. It's not just nicer, but it also results probably in money flowing more prolifically if the service experience has been optimized. So it is a part of professional experience these days to have excellent service, and therefore you need to optimize it. You get better user friendliness through service design. You will therefore also be more competitive because people like a good service. And everything becomes more relevant to your customer if the service experience is flawless. You wouldn't believe what you can sell if you do it nicely. Okay, let's imagine we are service design consultants and we are starting the service design process. Where do we begin? First of all, we need to understand our customers. That means, why do they behave the way they do? Shall we take an example? Somebody comes into a fast food place. What is their behavior? They come in quite, well, sometimes drunk, sometimes sober, sometimes politely, sometimes indifferently. There is a whole range of behaviors that people normally display when they are using a service, and you need to know what they are. These people have needs, and there are all kinds of different needs. Three to be precise, no more. One is the inarticulate need. The inarticulate need is a wonderful thing because it basically means things that the customer will need, but he doesn't know it yet. So that is one wonderful chance to be very visionary and offer something that people will flock for because it appeals to them out of a need that they feel. Such as, I always use this example. I believe that electric car usage is going to drive up coffee sales because people will be waiting by these little filling stations until they can continue. And you refuel a petrol car in 2 minutes, but you need 20 minutes to bring up an electric car back up to about 80% charge so that you can meaningfully go somewhere. So what do you do in that time? You go for coffee. So I think an inarticulate need of our society in the future is more coffee places and where they sell you coffee that you can drink within 15-20 minutes next to where your car is charging. Then there's the old customer need. The old customer need is a need that always stays the same. I'm using a police officer here to signify this, because the police will always have the same needs. The police will always need something to pursue criminals, to protect themselves with physically. They will have administrative needs and so on. And then there are the market needs, which can fluctuate and are really subject to fads and all sorts of things that we cannot foresee. And the third thing that we need to understand about our customer is the motivation. Now, you can enter into a service for all sorts of reasons, but I think the ones that I've listed here graphically on the right are pretty much the ones that you do. Either you're doing it for financial reasons, or out of emotional reasons, or you need to control something. These, I think, are the three service types that mean something for the motivation of your customer. Good, so we have gathered this information now. We service design consultants, what do we do next? We need to obviously gather this information. Let's just assume we've done that. And now we need to process this information. I think the best thing I can do now here for you is show you a case study. This isn't a real thing. This is, I've made this up, right? Okay, this is, let's just imagine we are creating a special pet sitting service for Savannah cats. I'm not sure if you know Savannah cats, obviously. They are the biggest house cat in the world, really nice, really cuddly, but very expensive and very lively, and they love to be out and about. So with a cat like that, you take no chances, especially when you're going on holiday and you're not taking the cat. You will want a pet sitting service for that kind of cat that doesn't get it wrong. You wouldn't want people who are only used to normal cats taking care of your precious Savannah cat. So here we are creating a pet sitting service for Savannah cats. These are the things we service designers now need to do. We will need to engage in some ethnography and some journalism and some visual portrayal. These three things. You will notice that ethnography and journalism have exactly the same points listed. Both do interviews, both do shadowing, and both do synthesis. I'm going to explain to you next what that means and why we have that way. Ethnography, as you might know, is all about studying culture. So it is a very intimate thing. It means you're getting under the skin of people, of beings, of a phenomenon, and you are exploring it at a very deep level. Journalism, though, is a view of a phenomenon from the public point of view. So it's all about the question, what does this mean for society as a whole? Let's go through this one by one, though. Now, the ethnographic part of our work as service designer. If you do interviews about the Savannah cat thing, you may make this interview completely about the cat. So you will have conversations, and these conversations will hopefully give you some answers that you can do something with. Questions might be something like, does your Savannah cat have a favorite chair? Or why do you even have a Savannah cat? Then you're shadowing your customer. Customer being the owner of the Savannah cat. You record everything they do and you follow them around. So if they're taking the cat for a walk, like they do here, you observe what they do, you observe what the cat does. And in the end, you form a synthesis of this, and you might write it all up nicely and come to a conclusion for yourself what the Savannah cat culture actually is. So that concludes the ethnographic part of your work. And then you're doing the journalistic part of your work. Now, here we're looking at things from the perspective of the public eye. In your interviews, you might be asking others who are not Savannah cat owners. You might ask, for example, pet shop people. So, who are these Savannah cat owners? What are they like? What do they want? What are their needs? When a Savannah cat owner comes to your pet shop, what does he clamor for? What does he take lots of? And all that. You can shadow these people by going online. Join one of those forums and try to get an idea what the phenomenon is like. And then in the end, again, you write it all up. And here your conclusion is, what is the Savannah cat phenomenon to society? So, could it be that Savannah cat owners actually drive up the beef price, something like that. So now that we have done our research, we create visual portrayals of things, as we might have an idea. And these ideas in visualizations, sketches, or even service prototypes. There are all sorts of service prototypes. I've listed a few down here. They call them test runs, beta versions. You can do role play, you can have videos, you can have storyboards. I'm going to go into a lot of detail on this in a little while here. So now that you know what the service designer does and why, I'll show you what tools the service designer uses. And I think I've got them all, but if not, by all means, please list them in the comments section. So first of all, what can we offer professionally as service designers? We can offer design activities. And they are really only four different kinds of design activities. We can design or co-design with our customers. We can envision stuff. We can test and prototype. And we can help implement or implement directly ourselves. Let's look at these. There is a lot of stuff here, so I hope you've got a good beverage next to you. Co-designing. It's a very good idea as a service designer to co-design, because you don't want to do this alone. The experience of others who have been involved in the service is priceless, and you may not have the experience yourself. Like, for example, you're going into a hospital to do some streamlining of their service experience. It is a good idea to have a few nurses and doctors and maybe even patients sitting around you. These are all the different little helpers that you can use to do co-designing with your customers. So perhaps we can build something from Lego together, you know, like a game. Do an actual design game. If you go online and check design games, you'd be amazed what's out there. There are oodles and oodles of different design games that you can play with people. You can put people together and do a bit of role play. And obviously, we're not talking Shakespeare here. We're talking, if it's a hospital setting, we're talking the patients will be patients, the nurses will be nurses, and the doctors will be doctors. And they're going to reenact something for your benefit so that you get it. Perhaps you can sketch something together. This will work best, obviously, when you're working with people from a fairly creative field who don't mind sketching. I'm not so sure if your doctors and nurses would be amused if you make them sketch, but who knows. You can use the very famous IDEO cards, also called issue cards. You can look these up, they're very famous, and they're a standard tool that most designers of all walks of design use. Basically, what they are is each card represents an issue, and you pull them at random and reflect on the issue that is mentioned there. The issue might be something like family or hygiene or time. So it's a very good way to start reflecting on stuff. You can do some rough prototyping with people. That means, Let's use our hospital analogy here. How would you do rough prototyping with your doctors and nurses and patients? You could make them act out a situation as they would want them to be. Let's say, for example, the nurses are unhappy with the amount of administration that needs to be done in their day, and they have an idea how to reduce that amount of administration. Make them act it out. Make them pretend that they are at work and that now they're doing it their way, if they had their way. So that could be rough prototyping in service design. Some people like to use post-it notes. Can be useful. You know, everybody puts up their ideas and then you stand around and talk about it. Why not? You can create a motivation matrix. There are many different ways of doing a motivation matrix. And this field in itself is big, so I think if you like the idea of a matrix, you better start reading up on the possibilities. I can't allude to them now because it would go way beyond the length of this lecture. You can, of course, always make mind maps. You can try to get your people to do some storytelling. The storytelling could be something like the patient goes, you know, this morning I was waking up at 5 and I rang for the nurse and nobody came. And I just had to get up myself, and then I pulled that thing out of the wall. And, you know, this would be storytelling when you have your stakeholders or actors involved. And you record that, obviously. And you write your own notes on the side. Or you create character profiles. So you've got the doctor, you've got the nurse, you've got the patient. That's three people, and perhaps that's all you have. But there will be a lot more people involved in the hospital experience. There will be visiting relatives. There will be kitchen personnel. There will be cleaning staff, and so on. Now, you can create a character profile for each one of these people, typically, and somebody can just get to, you can just get one of the present people to act that out. It saves you a lot of time. So another thing you can do together is envisioning. I think envisioning is just a nice way of saying dreaming. And it's a very important thing, because you need to find out where your customer actually wants to go with the service. So what you can do is you can dream up a service image that your customer would feel particularly happy with. To give you an example, in Germany, the AA, organization that picks up stranded motorists on the highways, is called the ADAC. And they've got the service image of the yellow angels, because their vehicles are yellow and they're coming to save people. So the service image of the yellow angel works really well in Germany. Everybody thinks these are nice people with yellow cars and they come and save you. So that could be a service image. Here is another matrix you could do. For envisioning, they recommend the touch points matrix, which allows you to create a service along points or dots that you define. You can do some evidencing, as they call it, archaeology of the future. Again, another thing you may want to read up on, this whole chain of terms here, it will bring up a host of things on the internet, and is worth reading about. You could create some realistic user archetypes, as they call them. So you can say, okay, what is a typical patient? You might create three different kinds of patients. Barbara, the child patient. Max, the athletic patient who hurt his foot. And then somebody who has something chronic and is always in for rehabilitation and stuff. So, but I think you get the point. We are creating archetypes, which means we give them names and we describe what their hobbies are and where they live. So we're making up these fake people who are nevertheless quite representative of those participating in the service we are designing. You could create an offering map. That's just a wish list of what you wish you could offer as a service or as part of your service. You may also need an actor's map, which means just a bunch of people, but perhaps arrows from one to the other, indicating what goes where and what they each do. You can create a blueprint, which allows you to very easily visualize a whole number of levels to a service. So you create here at the top, you can see you've got the primary interface where everybody is meeting, yeah, like the receptionist and the visitor. And then the deeper you go in the diagram, the more invisible everything becomes, because it's all happening behind closed doors. There you have the lab technicians, and you've got the people in the basement who run the heating system and all that. You could simply create a poster to envision the future service. Who knows what will be on that poster, but maybe somebody will have a creative streak and put something on there, like just an image, you know, maybe it's a little dog or whatever it might be that signifies something to those involved in the service design effort to move you on. A system map is a more comprehensive version of the blueprint. It goes not just from the upper part to the lower part, but it actually has depth. This is something you may even need to build in CAD or as a three-dimensional model. You can create an experience prototype together, which I think is aptly described with the metaphor of a sandbox. So you basically set up a hospital room and you play out different experiences. Maybe you video them, maybe you do an audio recording. Anyway, it is a controlled environment that you set up specifically for the experience, and it may have things in it that the current hospital room doesn't have, because obviously it's a prototype. You're testing new things in this controlled environment. You can create an actual mock-up of a service. Let's just say if the service is simply the remote control that calls the nurse, why not create that remote control? See where the buttons need to be, how readable they are. Mood boards are things designers, product designers, often create. For those of you who have not heard what a mood board is, it's very simple. It's like a photo album of things that are relevant to the service experience. So to make a mood board, what you need is you need a big piece of cardboard or a whiteboard, and then you grab yourself a magazine and start cutting out images that stand for relevant aspects of this service. Anything to convey the atmosphere of what goes on during the service. So you might cut out pictures of people and places and vehicles and objects, and you put them all together on one page, and it's quite amazing how powerful something like that can be. You can also dream up the future of your service together with your customer by imagining what headlines might be in the news about it in the future. The headline for the hospital could be, hospital in city such and such now has cats. I don't know, whatever, you know, something like that. Another thing is to create a storyboard, which is a way of telling the story, really, of what you want to happen. It makes sense when there are many steps to your service. So think of yourself as a cartoonist who draws the story of what happens while the service is being provided. Or you create a customer journey map. So if you already have a blueprint or system map, you can put in arrows just to show who communicates with whom, what happens after event X, Y, Z. It's quite straightforward. So much for that. So the next part is we are prototyping and testing a service. Now, I'm a product designer. So when I prototype and test something, it means there is an object in the room and you turn a crank and it will do stuff. Now, with a service design prototype, you have a slightly different scenario on your hands because you're dealing with people. So really, this is movie director time, where you need to start telling people what to do and people telling you what they feel. These are all the different things you can do to create prototypes and test your service with the help of perhaps your staff or your fellow students or even your customers directly. So you could perform what is called a constructive interaction. This means people are thinking out loud while acting. Let's just imagine it's a takeaway restaurant. We're in a takeaway restaurant and we want to optimize the service experience for the customer. So the customer, or the person playing the customer in this constructive interaction, would have to constantly communicate what he or she is thinking and anything else that comes across their minds. So they enter the restaurant, they order this thing, they get their onion rings, and if they are thinking, but I want free mayonnaise with these onion rings, then that is what they must be saying right then, because this whole constructive interaction is videotaped. And everything you feel while you are acting as a recipient of the service is useful in developing it further. You can take it a little further and actually create a better version of the service. That means you might put up something like a shop that is already run as if it were fully ready for the market, but it might just be one or two of these. Like if it's a McDonald's, for example, there might be five McDonald's in the world where they try one particular thing. Maybe a McDonald's where you can get hibachi. There might be five hibachi McDonald's in the world, and they will be the beta versions for what they might do later when all McDonald's have hibachi cooking. You can do this. It's called the Wizard of Oz. That method basically means you just observe people. You just pick out the random customer or the random employee, and you just observe them like as if you were National Geographic. And you film that whole thing, and you take notes, and you try to learn from that. You can also do an experience prototype. We used to call that a clinic 20 years ago in the States. The idea there is that you work with actual users. Back then, what we used to do, I used to design inline skates. We used to create a few prototypes and give them to kids who were then skating around with them. And we interviewed these kids on their experience of the prototype, which is why they call these things experience prototypes. You can also do what they call a use case. That means you just start doing this new service, even if it isn't completely developed. And whenever there is a problem, well, you fix it. And that is how it eventually becomes pretty good. This is probably where things like feedback is very useful. You know, all these comments that people use, that is probably often used for use cases. Again, you can just create an actual mock-up, if you can, of a service. So you just do everything like it will be done, only that it will be in only one location, and you gather your experiences based on that. Heuristic evaluation is a term that sounds much greater than it actually is. What it means is you judge the service experience of your prototype based on criteria that you've created before you started. The cognitive walkthrough is a very cost-effective way to test service experience, because you can do it without building anything. You can just get a focus group together, a few people around a meeting table, and one person who leads them through an imaginative experience. They might say something like, okay, now you close your eyes, and now you're imagining that you're going into a takeaway restaurant, and you're about to order some deep fried chicken. What happens next? So that's a cognitive walkthrough. And then there's the actual usability testing, which has its own criteria. If you want to check out usability testing, there will be lots of that on the web. And then finally, when we're done with all these things here, our service design will need to be implemented, and that needs us there because we have created it, and there's always a need to explain stuff when we first do something. So, what can we do when we implement a service design? You can analyze the tasks on a grid and see how well they're being performed, or if they're being performed at all. You can give your customer a script to read from. Now, when you're calling a call center or when you're calling your phone company, there's usually an operator at the other end, and they will be working with a script. They have been briefed, they know what they have to say, and is very strict. And that script is coming from a service designer. So you can give that to your customer. You can also give them a blueprint. We have seen this thing four times now. If it is something very quantifiable, you could simply write them a specification. Yeah, especially if it's just about operating machinery, for example, you can very simply write up a specification sheet. Here we are again with our service prototype. You can help set that up. So you can be around when they create the first fake shop of its kind and make sure that everybody says the right thing and wears the right thing. Or you hold hands of your customer while a use case happens. So this could be a long time, this could be years that the service is being used, and whenever there is a problem, somebody will report to you and go, how do we solve that? And then you charge again. So these were the things that we give our customers. Here are a few ideas in terms of the representations that you can use to communicate your service design ideas to your customer. You can do these five things, and there are subversions of each. You could, for example, choose to simply give your customer a text, a specification, storytelling. These would be the kinds of texts that sometimes a graph might help. So I would say a meaningful service design representation could be a map or a mind map or a diagram. You can simply tell people about stuff, so that would be called a narrative. And it's probably a good idea to not just tell them once, but to give them something lasting. So maybe a service image of some kind, more of an artistic representation of who you are. Maybe you remember my example of the German yellow angels. Why not have a big, gaudy painting of a yellow angel in the corner? That reminds everybody. A mood board, like I explained before, with all the happy images of people, objects, places to create a sense of atmosphere. You could put up some tomorrow headlines. Yeah, hospital now with cats. Or a storyboard, like a comic. You could create a game and give it to your customer. And I think that makes the most sense when your customer is a customer that has a lot of employees with a lot of turnover. for example, like a call center, you know, you don't want to have to come back in every time the call center has a new employee. You want to give these guys something that they can teach themselves how to be. And, well, we looked at the different games already. Maybe you can think of others. But Lego, design games, role play, group sketching, issue cards, they may or may not be right for briefing new call center people. But if you can gamify the briefing for the service providers, it's going to be very well received. And then again, here we are with our different models that we can give to our customers so that they understand what our service provides. You already know all these terms. I have already talked about them before, so I'll spare you that. I'll give you just, you know, to conclude with, I'll give you a bit of a background on service design, where it came from, how it all began. The first mention we have of service design is from this man, Shostak. It's 1982. And he gave us the notion that designing the service part of a product is actually a very important thing that shouldn't be separate from the product development. So there will have to be some marketing and management involvement in the designing of new products regarding the service, which means you design your products and services together for best effect. That was Shostak's thought, and I think it's a good one. We saw more and more products popping up after the 1980s that actually were developed in this way. For example, here we see mobile phones. A mobile phone isn't just an object. There's a lot attached there. There's a lot of service going on around it. And that is a designed experience as well. Shostak is also the man who actually gave us the service blueprint, which we have now seen too many times already. Well, you know, it is a map of a sequence of events, and it shows all the different functions. This man was the first academic who picked up on service design, and actually design discipline. And he did this with such enthusiasm that eventually he left teaching and started his own service design consultancy in London. And also he initiated various service design in these universities. And that is the story of service design in a nutshell. I hope you understand now what it is. And yeah, it is actually a fun thing to do. So take it on board, even if you may not be a 100% service designer, because as you've seen, most products these days come with designed service included. All the best.